Does it happen that sometimes your mind tells you that look around everybody else, that person has a great job, that person has a great relationship, a great husband, a great wife, a great career, a great business, a great health, a great education, a great level of beauty, but you don't have any of these. You are such a loser in life. Does it happen to you sometimes that your own mind tells you like that sometimes, that you don't have anything in this world? Oh, look, that person has it so much better than you. Not in a sense of envy, but you still feel sometimes, I wish I also had a life like that person. And nowadays with this social media, Facebook and Instagram, what's happening is everybody is putting that which they are not. They are only putting the best part of their life, the cream. Nobody is going to upload a photo in Facebook when they are crying. But because of the illusion, we think that everybody else is happy apart from us. So if that is sounding like you or somebody else, then you are at the right place, because today Queen Kunti is going to speak on what happens when you lose everything. But the question is, can anybody come to that position that he loses everything? Well, no, because there's still something which you don't lose. You might lose everything, but there's still something which you can never lose. Alright, so today we will see what that is. And that's what I have named this video as, Good News for Losers. So this video is for anybody who thinks that they have not achieved that much as their friends or their family members or as their enemies have achieved. Alright. So there you go. If you are new to the channel, then you can like this video, you can share this, and you can subscribe. And if you want a reading from me, then you can go to my website below, and you can also subscribe and share, and you can also watch the videos in this playlist. Alright. So we are going to read from Srimad Bhagavatam, 1st canto, 8th chapter, 27th verse. And before I begin, as I always say, God is there with you all the time. Just look to Him and He will help you if you lose everything. Okay, this is a very famous verse which Queen Kunti says. Namo kinchana vrittaya nivritta guna vrittaye atma ramaya shantaya kaivalya pataye namaha. It's a very famous verse. Translation: my obeisances are unto you who are the property of the materially impoverished. You have nothing to do with the actions and reactions of the material modes of nature. Material modes of nature means sattvagun, rajogun, tamogun, the mode of goodness, passion and ignorance. You are self-satisfied, and therefore you are the most gentle and are master of monists, the monists. Now, who is this he here? Yes, she is referring to Lord Krishna. So Queen Kunti is now going to speak about why losing something can be good sometimes. Alright. So the purport: a living being is finished as soon as there is nothing to possess. Oh my God, I lost this person, I lost that job, I lost this car. That's what happens, right? We feel as if we are dead. Therefore, a living being cannot be, in the real sense of the term, a renouncer. A living being renounces something for gaining something more valuable. A student sacrifices the childish proclivities to gain better education. A servant gives up his job for a better job. Similarly, a devotee renounces the material world not for nothing, but for something tangible in spiritual value. Srila Rupa Goswami, Sanatan Goswami and Srila Raghunath Das Goswami and others gave up their worldly pomp and prosperity for the sake of the service of the Lord. So these are names of great acharyas in the Gaudiya Vaishnava tradition who had renounced the entire world even when they had a lot of riches and lots of wealth. So that's what has been mentioned here, that we always need to renounce something sometimes, but we only do it to get better things. Sacrificing something to get something higher, that's what is mentioned. They were big men in the worldly sense, these acharyas. The Goswamis were ministers in the government service of Bengal, and Srila Raghunath Das Goswami was the son of a big zamindar of his time. Zamindar means landlord. The devotees are generally without material prosperity, but they have a very secret treasure house in the lotus feet of the Lord. There is a nice story about Srila Sanatan Goswami. Interesting. Very interesting story. He had Sanatan Goswami is one of the acharyas of the Gaudiya Vaishnav tradition. So there's the story. He had a touchstone with him, and this stone was left in a pile of refuse. A needy man took it, but later on wondered why the valuable stone was kept in such a neglected place. It was in the dustbin basically. Sanatan Goswami had left it there. So then this person, he therefore asked him for the most valuable thing. And then he was given the holy name of the Lord. Wow. What was given? The holy name of the Lord. Akinchana means one who has nothing to give materially. Akinchan. Tvam akinchana gocharam. That shloka is also there. A factual devotee or Mahatma does not give anything material to anyone because he has already left all material assets. He can, however, deliver the supreme asset, namely the personality of Godhead, because he is the only property of an actual devotee. The touchstone of Sanatan Goswami, which was thrown in the rubbish, was not the property of the Goswami. Otherwise, it would have not been kept in such a place. The specific example is given for the neophyte devotees, just to convince them that material hankerings and spiritual advancement go ill together. So, when we move ahead in our spiritual journey, there can be certain detrimental material attachments, like eating meat or having intoxication or gambling or indulging in illicit sex, which means premarital sex, and within marriage, outside marriage sex. So these activities are totally detrimental for our spiritual progress. So if we are having these attachments and we are also doing spiritual practices, we will eventually see that time passes by. 1 year, 2 year, 3 year, 4 years, 10 years will pass by. And if we continue to maintain those attachments, if we do not work diligently to uproot those negative things which are there in the heart, those poisonous elements, then it's written here that material hankerings and spiritual advancement go ill together. Then we will realize that we didn't make any spiritual progress. Unless one is able to see everything as spiritual in relation with the Supreme Lord, one must always distinguish between matter and spirit. A spiritual master like Srila Sanatan Goswami, although personally able to see everything as spiritual, set this example for us only because we have no such spiritual vision. So unless we are very, 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 very elevated spiritually, we should not say such things that, oh, everything is, everything is spiritual. This is also spiritual. That is also spiritual. We can't say like that because we are under the jurisdiction of matter now, at least as of now. So when we advance gradually and when we are very, very, very heavily, highly elevated, only then when we reach perfection, we can say that, okay, I will stay in this place and still I will not get contaminated. For example, suppose there is a person who is eating meat and we are not eating and we are trying to give up meat. So then we cannot claim that, oh, actually, you know, meat and vegetables both are same, there's no difference. No, we cannot claim that. So we have to discriminate that this is going to uplift me in my spiritual journey and this is not going to uplift me. Now, when we are so elevated that we are totally realized in God consciousness, then maybe if we are sitting with a person who is eating meat, we may not get affected. But in the initial stages, or even when we are trying to advance, then we need to make a distinction of what is good and what is bad, depending on the words of these scriptures, of course. Advancement of material vision or material civilization is a great stumbling block for spiritual advancement. Such material advancement entangles the living being in the bondage of a material body, followed by all sorts of material miseries. So the more you enjoy, the more you suffer, the more you get attached. And then more you want to enjoy, the more you suffer, the more you get attached. Such material advancement is called anartha, or things not wanted. Actually, this is so. In the present context of material civilization, one uses lipstick at a cost of 50 cents. And there are so many unwanted things which are all the products of material conception of life. So why is it mentioned about lipstick? Because they are using it to artificially decorate the dead body, which is anyways going to perish one day. The attempt to reach the moon is another example of spoiling energy, because even if the moon is reached, the problems of life will not be solved. The devotees of the Lord are called akinchanas because they have practically no material assets. Such material assets are all products of the three modes of material nature. They foil spiritual energy, and thus the less we possess such products of material nature, the more we have a good chance for spiritual progress. There it is. Good news. The Supreme Personality of Godhead has no direct connection with material activities. All his acts and deeds which are exhibited even in this material world are spiritual and without affection for the modes of material nature. That means he does not get affected by the material modes of nature, Lord Vishnu. In the Bhagavad Gita, the Lord says that all his acts, even his appearance and disappearance in and out of the material world, are transcendental, and one who knows this perfectly shall not take his birth again in this material world, but will go back to Godhead, which is the shloka that says this. So this is how we read the holy books. So whenever we see a reference, we try to recall which shloka does this come from. Okay, so in Gita, Lord Krishna says, janma karma cha me divyam evam yoveti tattvatah tyaktva deham punarjanma naiti mameti sorjuna. I'm repeating, okay. In the Bhagavad Gita, the Lord says that all his acts, janma karma, his appearance and disappearance in and out of the material world are transcendental. Janma karma cha me divyam. Divyam means divine. It is not like us, that we are being forced to take birth in a family. Like, we did not decide who our parents would be, right? We were forced to take birth in the family of somebody. But in case of Lord, it is not like that. So for example, Lord Ram, he decided that, Lord Vishnu decided that he will take birth in the family of Dasharath Maharaj. And in case of Krishna, Lord Vishnu said that I will take birth in the Yadu dynasty. So he decides, but we do not get to decide. So that's what is mentioned, that his appearance and disappearance is also divine. Disappearance also, how Lord disappears, God never dies, he disappears, but we die. So he only decides where he will disappear, how he will disappear, yes, from this world. Are transcendental. Janma karma cha me divyam. Divyam is the word. And one who knows this perfectly shall not take his birth again. Tyaktva deham puna janma naiti mameti sorjuna. Naiti. in this material world, but we'll go back to order. So one who knows this, now you may say that, oh, I also know this now because it's mentioned, but it's not the theoretical knowledge which we have. We have to realize that God is completely a divine being. Only then that happens. The material disease is due to hankering after and lording it over material nature. This hankering is due to an interaction of the three modes of material nature. In Gita it is said, you know, tribir gunamair bhavair. And neither the Lord nor the devotees have attachment for such false enjoyment. So one who is spiritually elevated will not hanker after material enjoyment. This does not mean that he will run away from his family and go to the forest. No, he will behave like a normal human being. So for example, if he is married, like somebody like Yudhishthir Maharaj or Prithu Maharaj or Dhruva Maharaj, these are all grihasthas who were married. Arjuna was married, Draupadi was married, Kunti Devi who is speaking this, she is also married. Although when she is saying this, she is a widow, but she was married once upon a time. So whatever is required for our material, I mean whatever is required to keep the material body going, we do that. Like we eat food 2 times or 3 times a day depending on our requirement. Then we need relationships, so we get married, we have a husband, we have a wife, we have children, that's perfectly fine. And we need money, so we work, or we have our own business, or maybe we have our own YouTube channel. Whatever it is, that's perfectly fine. But the attachment should not be there towards hankering. Like in the mundane materialistic society, if you go, you will see a man and a woman, they are discussing where they can go and enjoy in the best possible way. Yes, honeymoon, premarital honeymoon, postmarital honeymoon. They will celebrate honeymoon after 40 years of marriage also sometimes. Yes, of course you can go and have a good time, that's not prohibited, of course, but I hope you are understanding the essence of what I am trying to speak here. That people are so much obsessed, their attachment, the asakti is so high that every time they have something, they will always want something more. Yes, like people can purchase a car, but they will not purchase. They will purchase Mercedes, they will purchase Rolls Royce, they will purchase BMW. So because of that, what happens is they have to keep working more and more and more and more and more and more and more. Because if you take a normal car, that may not be very costly, but if you take a Mercedes in India, that will cost you around 30-35 lakhs. So then you have to have a job which pays you around 1 lakh-2 lakh rupees per month. Then you must struggle 18 hours you must work. The material disease is due to hankering after and lording it over material nature. This hankering is due to an interaction of the three modes of nature. And neither the Lord nor the devotees have any attachment for such false enjoyment. Therefore, the Lord and the devotees are called Nivritta Gunavritta. The perfect Nivritta Gunavritti is the Supreme Lord because he never becomes attracted by the modes of material nature. Whereas the living beings have such a tendency. Some of them are entrapped by the illusory attraction of material nature. Because the Lord is the property of the devotees and the devotees are the property of the Lord, reciprocally, the devotees are certainly transcendental to the modes of material nature. Krishna also says this in the Gita. Daivi esha gunamai mama maya duratyaya mameva mepa pradyante maya itam tarantite. Krishna says there that Daivi Hesha Gunamai, this material nature of consisting of three modes, is extremely difficult to overcome, which almost means it's impossible. And then he says, but if you take shelter of me, you can cross over it. Mame Vamye Prapadyante Mayam Yetam Tarantite. You will transcend Tarantite. This is a natural conclusion. Such unalloyed devotees are distinct from the mixed devotees who approach the Lord for mitigation of miseries and poverty or because of inquisitiveness and speculation. The unalloyed devotees and the Lord are transcendentally attached to one another. For others, the Lord has nothing to to reciprocate, and therefore he is called Atmaram, self-satisfied. Self-satisfied as he is the master of all monists who seek to merge into the existence of the Lord. Such monists merge with the personal effulgence of the Lord called the Brahma Jyoti, but the devotees enter into the transcendental pastimes of the Lord, which are never to be misunderstood as material. So basically that's what is being said in this purport, that we may think that we have lost something very valuable, but that can become a great source of spiritual advancement, because we may understand that this material world is a place of misery, then we will do spiritual practices seriously, and then we will become very serious, and then when our consciousness is elevated, we will no longer be trapped by material things. Of course, that's a very high stage, easier said than done, but that's what can be, that is how loss can be a very great blessing. Okay, so the next time you think that you have lost something, or your mind says you are a loser, so then you have to tell yourself that akinchan is the word, you see. Akinchan means one who does not possess anything, but he possesses Lord Krishna, because Lord Krishna also says in the Gita, Ishvara sarva bhutanam hriddeshe arjuna tishthati. I am situated in the heart of all living beings. So you can never lose, you can never lose God. Alright, so the only thing we need to do is, we need to do our spiritual practices diligently every day without fail, and we need to maintain good association of spiritually minded people. Try to read the scriptures, the holy books like Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam, and we also need to associate with holy sages whenever possible, in the weekends and in the holidays, instead of going to places like Goa. We can visit Kanchipuram sometimes, alright? And not that after going to Kanchipuram, we enjoy their South Indian food and all this, we waste our time like that. We should go to the Varadaraj temple, which is a temple of Lord Vishnu. Then we can also visit Ekambarishwar temple, which is temple dedicated to Lord Shiva. And there are so many temples, alright? Or if you are in North, you can visit Banaras, you can visit Mathura, Vrindavan, so many places are there. Okay, if you are new, then like, comment, share and subscribe, and if you want a consultation, then go to my website below, and God is there with you all the time. Just look to him and you will find him. So the next time, you will never be a loser. Okay, until next time, bye bye, see you.